We are going to be talking about the NFL today. Can you imagine that? I just cannot believe what we are seeing. We are in a blue pill society, folks. There is no doubt in my mind. Stay with me. Welcome to my show. This is Suzanne Shattuck at Wide Awake on talkamericaradio.us. I want to always say hi to the folks out there listening on 107.5 FM. That's WJHC. We have 92.1 FM, WDDQ, and those people at 1330 AM, WLBB. Folks, look, we're gonna discuss this NFL situation ad nauseum, and I am just going to hate to tell you, but it's just me this time. I hope you'll listen to the whole show, but it's just going to be me chatting with you guys today. I can remember I'm a big Rush fan, and I'm actually going to go over an article that he wrote a little later in the show. But I'm trying to think if he used to have like the fireside chat. I remember for a very short period of time, he was on TV, and I loved his radio and TV, but I guess, you know, he's just more comfortable in the medium of radio. But I'm just gonna have like a fireside chat with you guys about some things that I think that have been grossly ignored, some things that are going on right now. There's a trial situation of an incident that happened 3 years ago, the beheading of a woman who happened to be white at a factory. I believe it was in Oklahoma. Had her head cut off by a Muslim living here in America. And there's virtually zero coverage on this. And it isn't any wonder, because, you know, it just doesn't fit the narrative of the left. So we're going to definitely be going over that. That's going to be an article by Leo Homan. Chatted with him a little bit this afternoon, and I always like to put his articles out there. He does tremendous work, works extremely hard, making sure everything is right with what he prints. So we're going to be talking about that. We're going to be discussing some of the refugee situation and how we've got our own refugees now, with Irma and Harvey, and now this other, I can't remember the name of it, that went through Puerto Rico and just laid waste apparently to that island. Apparently there's nothing green left. I mean, I was reading some article saying it's just like apocalyptic looking devastation, and that's just going to be, if you consider the seriousness of just not having power for that length of time, you consider the food. I just remember, I don't know if it was my sister, something happened where they lost power, and they were helping somebody clean, I think their lake house or something. They were helping clean the refrigerator and the freezer out. And I'm talking, you wouldn't believe, she said, the stench of the rotten meat and stuff that was in, you know, the refrigerator and the freezer. Now think about that on that whole island. Think about the, you know, and I don't know if generators have been able to keep things frozen or whatever, but you think about all the grocery stores, the tons of rotten food there. It's got to be just a horrible place to be right now. And to even consider, you know, just even consider the fact that we would be spending tax money, our taxpayer dollars on anybody bringing them here from another country, when we've got people that are in, you know, in Texas and in Florida and then Puerto Rico. You know, this is just craziness. It is absolutely crazy that we would even be considering bringing anybody else into this country right now that needs housing and food and clothing and education and translators. It makes absolutely no sense. And I don't mean to be sounding mad. I need to watch my volume. But it just, like, again, so many things in our life right now just seem so upside down. And I don't think, almost anything has been so making my mouth just hang open as this in there's a story of this NFL, what is going on in the NFL, and the absolute disrespect to our flag. So we're going to talk about that. I'm going to open up talking about an article about one of the Pittsburgh Steelers. There was one, apparently, this past Sunday, there was one player out of I don't know how many are on the team that left that tunnel to stand, put his hand over his heart for the national anthem. And his name, hold on, this article I think was in Daily Signal. And I think I got it off Rich Swire. You know, I talk about Rich Swire as well. It was on his website, but it's from the Daily Signal. And it's Alejandro Villanueva. He is, let's see, what is his position? He is the offensive tackle for the Steelers. He is a veteran, served three tours of duty in Afghanistan. He's an Army Ranger, recipient of the Bronze Star, and now he's in the Army National Guard. So this man has seen combat, and he is out there, you know, doing what any normal American would stand in respect for our national anthem and salute the flag. And anyway, he goes out, and then apparently the coach, Mike Tomlin, said that, this is what I can't believe in this article. It said Villanueva drew criticism from Steelers head coach Mike Tomlin. He said, like I said, I was looking for 100% participation. We are going to be respectful of our football team, Tomlin said. And the article goes on to say, while his coach disagreed with Villanueva's actions, the veterans of foreign wars praise Villanueva's actions for showing the rest of his team and the league what true metal is. Yeah, I agree with the VFW's, you know, how they talked about Villanueva's actions. But to say for the coach to say he disagreed with Villanueva's actions. So, Coach Tomlin, you're saying that you disagree with somebody who is standing and showing respect for our flag. That is what he is saying. And yet, I don't know, somebody double check me here, but has Mike Tomlin come out and ever said that he's disappointed or disagreed with the actions of the other players who have kneeled showing disrespect to our flag? I highly doubt it. So, you know, at first I'm thinking, man, this is so awesome. Here, this, you know, young veteran, hero, really, that has served our country with honor, and here he is being a leader. He is one. I just love it. And I'm going to talk a little bit about what I woke up thinking this morning. But he was one that went out and stood. But guess what happens? I was so disappointed. Monday, apparently, at a press conference, Villanueva said this: I threw my teammates under the bus unintentionally. Article goes on to say that he said, quote, every single time I see that picture of me standing by myself, I feel embarrassed, he added, according to a CBS Pittsburgh affiliate station, referring to how he was the only Steeler out of the tunnel during the anthem. And then he said this. He said, people that are taking a knee are not saying anything negative about the military. They're not saying anything negative about the flag. They're just trying to protest that there are some injustices in America, Villanueva said. And I have to step back and say, you know what? Here I was just thinking, here is a leader. This guy's standing up, doing what other people aren't doing because in his gut he knows it's the right thing to do. And then I kid you not, apparently, I mean, I'm assuming that somebody came down from up top and said, look, guy, if you want your job, you better get in line. Listen, what country are we in anymore? And this is why I love our president. Now, I get on my radio show, and I will call it like I see it. If I think President Trump is doing things that I don't agree with, I'm going to say that because this is my show, and I can give, you know, what my opinion is. But I will say this about Trump, and this is what got him into the presidency. I have said it from day one. I said it before he was even elected. He came out and said what millions of Americans have been dying to say. He had the pulse of the American people, just like he has the pulse on the American people, what they think about this NFL business. The majority of real Americans, of patriotic Americans, would obviously be standing for our national anthem, and they would not want these players to be allowed to kneel. It's disrespectful. It is unsportsmanlike conduct, period. And the coaches, again, I'm telling you, when stuff, we've just got so much to talk about. And I have this friend who is a very high altitude thinker. He's very lofty thinking. He sees the forest, and I tend to be one that likes to get in the weeds and just, you know, look at all the details of things. So I'm going to try to keep my talk today from a high altitude perspective, and then we'll come down and look at things on a ground level, and then we'll go back up, because all this, what we're going to be talking about, has to do, again, with control. But I want to get back, finish my point about Trump, because I know I tend to go down rabbit holes a lot. But what I love about Trump is the fact that he came out, he had some Twitters, and I got so fired up and jazzed over the weekend when I saw him saying things like, you know, and I'm going to say it on the radio, other people, you know, I'm just quoting my president, but he said, if you see one of these, he thinks that if the coaches see these players out taking a knee during the national anthem, he ought to tell them to get the sons of bitches off the field, say you're fired. And I think he is exactly right. And then he said this too. He said, if a player wants the privilege of making millions of dollars in the NFL or other leagues, he or she should not be allowed to disrespect our great American flag, our country, and should stand for the national anthem. And if you're not, you're fired. Find something else to do. Totally agree with our president. And you know where the second punch comes? Is when Trump does not apologize. He does not apologize for what he says. Have you noticed that? He is one of the absolute, I don't even know if there's anybody else that does it. He does not apologize for what he says. He stands behind what he says. And yes, sometimes when he says things, you know, it's less than tactful, but he means what he says. And I'm telling you, when he said this, you can feel the gut feeling that he loves this country. And so I'm just saying, I love that he said this. One other thing about this article before we move on, very important, I think, awesome quote by Villanova. He said this, quote, "I don't know if the most effective way is to sit down during the national anthem with a country that's providing you freedom, providing you $16 million a year, when there are black minorities that are dying in Iraq and Afghanistan for less than $20,000 a year." Think about it. That was excellent. I'm going to say it one more time. Villanova, this is the one Pittsburgh Steeler that came out of the tunnel to stand for the anthem. He said, "I don't know if the most effective way is to sit down during the national anthem with a country that's providing you freedom, providing you $16 million a year, when there are black minorities that are dying in Iraq and Afghanistan for less than $20,000 a year." I mean, our military men and women get paid next to nothing. They got their lives on the line. And these NFL spoiled, rotten brats that are kneeling, they deserve zero respect. Zero respect. It's incredible what we're witnessing here, folks. When we come back, we're going to talk about Rush's article, which, I mean, I'm telling you, Rush is, he's a national treasure. He really is. And I'm very thankful that I had the time to listen to him when I was, actually when I was raising my kids, because I stayed home with them. And oh my word, you know, every noon, I can remember my one of my oldest, she would be humming that, you know, the Rush music while, you know, she was sitting in the high chair. I mean, she got so used to it. But I can't say enough about Rush. And I really feel, you know he loves the NFL. I mean, oh my word, he just loves the sport. And but he's really sad by what has happened. And we're going to go into his article and spend a little time there when we come back. And I may try to get somebody on the third segment. We'll see. We'll see if we can get somebody on. But you all hang with me. And I hope you're having a wonderful day. It's been a beautiful day up where I am. And I just so enjoy the beauty of our country. And I hope you do too. And we will be right back. Don't go away.
Hey, Donna, let's talk about a new network that's out. You can watch this, ladies and gentlemen, on any of your phone devices, your iPads, your computers, smart TVs. It's available almost any place, and it's called CRTV. And what that stands for, ladies and gentlemen, is Conservative Review Television. Now, the hosts that are on there, Donna, who are some of the hosts that are on this? I want you to tell the people about them.
Just the very best talk show hosts you could imagine. Mark Levin, Michelle Malkin, Mark Stein, and Steven Crowder, just to name a few.
Here's the other thing about this, ladies and gentlemen. This is on demand. This television and this network works around your schedule. And all you do is you log in. And you watch. You can watch Mark Levin. You can watch Michelle Malkin. You can watch Crowder, Steven Crowder.
Mark Stein.
You can watch Mark Stein. Any of these great conservative hosts on demand, and they're ready to perform and educate you whenever you're ready, whenever you can fit it into your schedule. Now, go to crtv.com, hit the /cowboy. So it would be crtv.com/cowboy. Or you can put cowboy in the promo code. You're going to get a discount if you do this. So please, ladies and gentlemen, Donna and I are subscribers to this. We don't get it free because of being affiliated with CRTV. These are just good friends that really know how to educate the right way. It's not fake news.
Hi, this is Donna Fiducia, co-host of Cowboy Logic Radio. For 28 years, I was in the mainstream media, most recently as an anchor at the Fox News Channel. No more. Ladies and gentlemen, the mainstream media has completely failed the American people. Radio networks like Talk America Radio will not fail you. Radio shows like Cowboy Logic Radio will not fail you. Check out the entire roster of over 60 weekly radio shows by visiting talkamericaradio.us. That's talkamericaradio.us.
talkamericaradio.us. Accuracy and range are a necessity. Now comfort is an option as well. Nemo Arms introduces the Omen 300 Win Mag. The Omen 300 is perfectly balanced for reduced recoil, creating sub-minute of angle accuracy. And fit with the tightest of tolerances, the Omen is offered in carbine or full-length models with a 10 or 14 round magazine. American made, owned, and designed, Nemo Arms is setting a new standard in modern sporting rifles. Find out more at NemoArms.com.
Welcome back to the show. Look, I'm continuing to talk about this NFL situation. because I really do think this is a watershed moment. I mean, we are standing and observing a populace that has been marinating in a completely politically correct and alternate life. And it's totally like a blue pill populace society is what we're living in. And we, not that we want to, but we're in the middle of it as well. We are living in the middle of it. And what appears to freedom-loving Americans, the majority of us, freedom-loving Americans, that this is sheer lunacy, what is going on. I mean, I have to say, I was so surprised when I read that article, you know, one Pittsburgh Steeler, one big, tough, and this guy is big and tough, and he made a decision that should have been an easy decision for these big, tough football players. And yet, apparently, these coaches, as you're going to hear in Rush's article coming up here, it's like these coaches are wanting to protect their pansy players. I don't know. What, you got to be kidding me. These are supposed to be big, tough guys, and yet they're being sheltered from making what should be an easy decision. I'm telling you right now, and forgive me if I'm getting a little loud, but this really hits me. This really affects me, and I know it does you guys out there too. It's a visceral thing. I mean, any number of my kids would not blink if somebody asked them, "Are you going to kneel or stand for the national anthem?" These are young people that know better. I am totally amazed at the lack of courage of these NFL players. I mean, at what point are you going to stand on principle? I mean, seriously, this is beyond belief for me. I was talking to one of my kids, and we were remembering, and I think I've shared this on the show before. You know, when you grow up on a military base and you hear the music playing when they're putting the flag up and when they're taking it down at the end of the day at 5 o'clock. And buddy, I'm telling you what, when you hear the music, you are to stop your car. Even if you're in the middle of the road, you are to stop your car. Your kids get out, you get out, you put your hand on your heart. You face wherever you know the flag, you know, the big flagpole is on that base. That's the direction that you're facing. You do not turn your back on the flag, and you put your hand over your heart, and you show respect. And you show the respect to that flag, the respect to the people who have, you know, died protecting our country. I mean, it's just, again, I have a friend that gave me a flag recently that they had carried when they were overseas, doing some, you know, very dangerous stuff. And I'm like, that flag, I cherish that flag. I mean, you know how you're not supposed to leave it out in the dark. You're not supposed to let it fall on the ground. And here we are kneeling and showing total disrespect for it. And not only that, I don't know if you all remember, I think this might have been last week, but that there's some little football team, I think they're like 8-year-old boys up in Chicago somewhere, and the coach, you know, every single one of those players, 8-year-old boys, back to the flag, kneeling during the national anthem. I don't know. I'm telling you, pull your kids out of school. Pull your kids out of these sports programs if the coaches don't know what it is to respect this country. Since when is it a bad thing to be proud to be an American? I'm telling you, when did it happen? It's a creeping thing that's been happening, and all of a sudden this is just turned on a dime. But what is encouraging to me, what is very encouraging to me, even though these big tough NFL players are having trouble standing out there and respecting our flag and respecting those in the military, and it does go to that. Don't tell me that you're out there protesting about law enforcement and the false narrative that there is out there, that there's there's racial injustice out there across the board. That's false. That is a falsity. Is that a word? But it is. Don't tell me that people aren't falling into this false. And I'm telling you, I laid this at the feet of the media. I laid this at the feet of, actually, let's go higher than that, because that's what I said. I need to go high. If you look at this high altitude perspective, it's the left. The left is politicizing, everything. I started thinking about this the other day. It's like everywhere you look in America, every single little nook and cranny, you turn a stone over, whatever's under it, the left is going to try to make it a divisive political issue. You look at culture. You look at Hollywood, the media. Our music is politicized. Our food is even politicized. Like, Burger King, are we going to wrap it in a rainbow colored wrapper? And what kind of food are we serving here? Oh, we serve halal food. Everything is politicized. Clothing is politicized. Gender, religion, health care. And yes, health care is politicized. And while I'm at it, I'm just going to tell you this. And this is something I was thinking, and this is just something I'm sharing. There's no HIPAA violation here. I'm just saying, we're taught that, okay, let's say you have a transgender somebody that comes into, where you're working, and you have to address them as what they feel at the moment. Even if it's an obvious man that gives you a girl name, you're supposed to, then turn off everything inside you that wants to just naturally say he, like look at his feet or his hands, and you're supposed to say she, look at her hands, look at her feet. I'm telling you, it is difficult. It is difficult. And I look at that and I said, this is absolutely insanity. This is insanity. You look at, there's human anatomy, right? You go human anatomy and physiology. If you're in the medical field, you're taught things. And guess what? When you have a certain, parts, you're a man. If you don't and you have other things, you're considered a woman. And that's a fact. Those are facts. And yet in the healthcare field, you have professionals. Think about this. Professionals that are now being told, forget about the anatomy and physiology classes, just throw them out the window because we're in a different world. Remember, we're in the blue pill world. So now you have to try, and I'm telling you already, it's hard to do. It's very, very difficult. And I'm thinking, just like with these coaches, leadership in our country is so, so important. Because you know what real leaders do? Real leaders stop this kind of stuff from trickling down to the rest of the people. Okay, somebody comes to the leader, the CEO of a company, the principal of a school, the administrator of a hospital, and they try to push this, it's my favorite word to say, although I'm not going to say it. I need to get away from saying it. But they push this insanity in through these leadership, people that are in leadership positions. And let me tell you, if the person in leadership position does not stand on principle, okay, does not stand on a foundation of truth, then this is what happens. You have insanity, things that do not make sense, things that are not common sense, that permeate that organization. It permeates the school, it permeates the hospital, it permeates the football organization. Okay? Do you see what I'm saying? Leadership is so important, and we have allowed people in leadership positions get there, and the only way they get there anymore is if they're politically left. And this is what we have, folks. And that's why you look at the alternative. You look at like your Hobby Lobbies. You look at your Chick-fil-A's. Those are some well-oiled businesses that do well, that have happy customers. And I'm telling you, it starts with the leadership. I'm sorry. I am on a soapbox. I need to get people back here so I can interview them, because I don't know if y'all could take me week in and week out with just me talking. But let me finally get to Rush's article real quick. Just some things that I highlighted. He's got such a way with words. But he said, look, Rush said, look, I got this Sunday, September 25th. It says, with great sadness, I did not watch the National Football League on Sunday. He says, I was not sad after Friday night when the president made his comments. I had no doubt afterward what the reaction was going to be, and I had no doubt where public opinion was going to fall. I had no doubt how people in the NFL, from players to the commissioner to media people, were going to get it wrong, and they have, and they did. He said, the mystique is gone. The belief, the wish, the desire that the people in the game were the best and the brightest and special. And that's why they were there. That's why they were there. And that's gone. And it's been politicized. It's been politicized and corrupted. And it didn't start this weekend. It started years ago. And then Rush continues. He says, look, and the people politicizing it, since we're talking about politics, the people that politicize it are people on the left. And when that happens, things change and it's just over. I'm telling you, they ruin things, don't they? That's my opinion. And then this is what the coach said, I think, of the Steelers. And Rush was talking about this. The coach, Tomlin, said, I need to protect my players. Yeah, I want to make sure they don't have to decide that when they're out there, they don't have to decide whether they're going to take a knee or put their hand over their heart. I have to protect my players. Now, is that not pathetic? That is so pathetic. That's why I like, in my show, I like to call out and give a shout out to real men out there, because love you guys. You all are awesome, and keep it up. Anyway, more of Rush. This all started before Donald Trump. You know what I fear? Based on things I've seen, based on things I've read, based on things I've heard, it seems that a lot of people still believe hands up, don't shoot happened. A lot of people who believe hands up, don't shoot, Ferguson, Missouri, that Michael Brown was an innocent victim running away from a policeman and was shot in the back while having his hands up saying don't shoot. It didn't happen. It is a false narrative that the media spread and spread, and the protesting agitators spread it. And it has taken on a life of its own that it never had. It was never true, and significantly, a lot of people believe it, and other things similar to it that didn't happen or didn't happen the way they were reported. Now, on a side note, I want to say that the left has created a Frankenstein with this Antifa, with the Black Lives Matter, with all these agitators that are getting violent. They have created Frankenstein, and they cannot control it. They cannot control it. But it's their fault. They're the ones that did it. Getting back to Rush's article. He's talking about this. He says, you put a camera on that corner. He said, because apparently how most people view life is through the lens of media. And he said, you can put a camera on that corner when people know it's there and their behavior changes. So the people who know the camera's there are going to change their behavior. He said, I'm not arguing to remove cameras. Don't misunderstand. And I'm not playing the violins wishing for the good old days. He's just trying to illustrate that that's how people see life, is through the lens of the media. So life is a stage, right? Life is a stage. And like I said, we are not in reality. It's some drama being played out that people are just following, like I said, this narrative, and they've got to go along with it. Rush said this too. I know we're getting a little short on time. Coming up on a break, I want to finish a few more sentences. The one thing this is not going to do is make the NFL more popular. It's not going to make the NFL more ingrained in our society. You simply cannot have a business that allows itself to be used to promote social justice when that promotion of social justice requires displays of anti-Americanism, however you want to define it. You can't watch the NFL anymore and just watch football. You can't watch ESPN anymore and just learn that what happened during the day in the football games. You just can't. When we come back, we're going to finish Russ's article. Don't go away, okay? We'll be right back.
This is Don Newen, co-host of the Drive Time Sit Rep. Join me as I call in to my intel analyst, Denise Simon, for my daily situation report, or Sit Rep, the Drive Time Sit Rep. Check talkamericaradio.us for more information and showtimes.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. My name is AJ Gaynor, host of Blow and Smoke. Who is AJ Gaynor? Well, he's formerly the drummer for national recording artist 12 Stones, who you've probably never heard of, but why does he have a show? Well, he's widely read, widely traveled, and he enjoys the search for new perspectives. Why should you listen? First, because this is not your father's talk show. Second, because the idea here is each week I sit down with you for about an hour, and we discuss some current events, usually the political ones, but not always, and we try and identify what's real, and of course, what's the propaganda. We know the mainstream media has a narrative they're pushing, and on Blow and Smoke, we challenge that narrative, sometimes with simple facts, other times with instinctive logic, but always with truthful, honest debate. I've always said that my show is about finding perspective. I believe the perspective I provide my listeners is indeed unique. Tune in to Blow and Smoke with yours truly, AJ Gaynor, right here on the Talk America Radio Network and at talkamericaradio.us.
Hi, this is Donna Fiducia.
And Don Newen from Cowboy Logic Radio. Ladies and gentlemen, if you don't go to sleep every night completely fatigued from trying to restore America from the destruction that is taking place,
then you're simply not doing enough. Join us every Tuesday night, 9 p.m. Eastern, for Cowboy Logic Radio.
Let the restoration begin.
Donald Trump came to Washington vowing to drain the swamp and make government work for the American people. But the swamp creatures in D.C. aren't going down without a fight, and the deep state is determined to overturn the election and keep their gravy train rolling. In these turbulent times, it's critical for patriots to stay engaged and be prepared to defend this president. You can stay up to date on Trump's battle to make America great again by listening to America First Radio with Jim Dawes each weeknight at 10 p.m. Eastern on the Liberty Feed.
Hi, I'm Michelle Malkin for Conservative Review. If you are sick of the clown show, freak show, scream fests on cable TV, you have to subscribe to Mark Levin's new TV show at LevinTV.com.
Now, just wanted to finish up with Rush's article. This, I think, is very important, too. Very good point. Rich Lowry, he writes for National Review Online, and he wrote this article the other day, and he filed a piece yesterday called Why Trump is President, and his Alabama speech Friday night and his comments on the NFL is what Rich Lowry now realizes is why Trump is president. It isn't complicated. You have a man who is very clear in his love for the country, his love of its traditions, and his appreciation for it. And on the other side, you have people who are willing to portray themselves as not, whether they know it or not. There's no way Trump loses in this. You may think so, but there's no way he does. There is no way the NFL wins if this continues as it is. The ratings are down last night. The early returns we don't have, of course. All the metered markets, the overnights, some of them are in, but they were down. And it's not insignificant, the numbers that are down. So we're going to watch this, obviously. This is just huge. And like I said, I think it is a moment where, you know, I was thinking the other day, we're either gonna kneel in submission or we're going to stand for freedom. I mean, it's one of the two. It's one of the two, and it should be an easy choice. I'm not going to say it's be easy to live it, but it should be an easy choice. Because, again, all these movements, all these organizations, whether you're talking about the leftists, the Marxist, the globalists, the Islamic, you know, movement, they all want control over you. They do not want the individual to have rights. They want it all to be the collective, you know, go along with the flow. You know what I'm, I mean, that's kind of how it seems to me. I mean, we used to be the melting pot, right? But the left just wants to divide, because, you know, obviously, you know, when you're divided, you can be conquered. And we need to consider what's going on in the minds of, you know, those in North Korea, those in China and Russia. What do we look like to them right now? I mean, anyone over here, you know, who adheres to our constitutional, the tenets of our Constitution, of free speech, freedom of religion, freedom to bear arms, you know, freedom to assemble, we will continue to be singled out. Okay, we are indeed at a crossroads. And like I said, we're going to stand or we're going to kneel. Okay, I woke up this morning, I think, with several thoughts in my mind about this. I know I'm just kicking this, I mean, to death, this issue. But I started thinking about the biblical story of King Nebuchadnezzar. You know, when he built the, you know, he wanted everybody kneeling to him. And you had Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego that said, you know, nope, we're not going to do it. Because that's going to go against our faith, you know, in our God. And we're not going to kneel to you. And, you know, they got thrown in this fire. And I believe the people even threw them in the fire. The fire was so hot it even killed the people that put them in the fire. And God protected them. And so that changed, you know, changed King Nebuchadnezzar. But look, what was Nebuchadnezzar wanting? He wanted people to kneel to him because he wanted to control them, right? That's what he desired. But I just thought, wow, what courage. I mean, you think about, you know, a story of all time that just speaks about courage, and that definitely is one that comes to mind. The other two things I thought about, and a lot of times I'll wake up for some reason, I don't know if I'm dreaming about this stuff or what, or maybe I'm thinking a little, hopefully a little bit clear in the morning, but I thought about, there's a picture somewhere somebody shared with me about a Hitler, and he has, you know, several of his, the SS standing with him, and on the other side, they're at a concentration camp. On the other side of the concertino wire is this one emaciated concentration camp, you know, Holocaust victim, and he is staring Hitler, staring him down. I mean, what courage with that young man. And then there's another one too, and I believe same thing. It's a German street, and I believe, you know, all these people are saluting Hitler, doing the Heil Hitler, and there's one person in the crowd that doesn't. Like one person that has their hands down. You know, and I thought about, wow, that's so cool. I was thinking about the, you know, the Pittsburgh Steeler guy, that one guy coming out of that tunnel. The only thing I wish is that he hadn't backed up or backed off. You know, full steam ahead. If you're gonna do that, then don't apologize. You know. Anyway, then another thought too. Another thought I had was about the Patriot when it comes to our flag, because, you know, it is so disrespectful to it. And when you consider, do y'all remember the Patriot? That movie, the Patriot, had Mel Gibson in it, and Heath Ledger, and it was about the Revolutionary War. I think Mel Gibson portrays this man named Benjamin Martin, and he's forced into joining the revolution. He had fought before, but anyway, together Heath Ledger is his son, and they both are fighting in the same battles. And Heath Ledger really, I mean, he is so about freedom and about the revolution and about that flag. And I'm telling you, he picks that flag up and he carries it around, and he's mending it. It shows him in numerous scenes where he's painstakingly trying to sew this flag back together because of the meaning of it. You know, and when they were fighting, if somebody dropped that flag, you know, then somebody else would scoop it up quickly to carry it, and it was so important. And, you know, that's, again, I just think about, it's just sad. It's just sad. But at the same time, I think this gives us such an opportunity, you know, to stand up, such an opportunity to, you know, go against the grain, you know what I mean? And the other thing I just want to speak about just real quickly, too, is look, when you see how divided we are, and like I said, more and more, the left just loves this division. They love to find something that divides us. But I say we try to, look, we need to win at least 10% of the people that are in, and I call it, it's almost like the enemy camp, those on the left. It really is. They're so against our freedom. But don't tell me there aren't at least 10% in that, on that other side, that are looking at this, especially when it comes to this flag issue. I think this has got to really affect some people, and they've got to be questioning, who am I with? You know what I'm saying? There has got to be a way for us to reach out some kind of common ground and bring 10% of those people over to our, you know, to those who want to preserve freedom. Does that make sense? Sometimes I don't know if I'm making sense, but I think that can be done. And we just need to find, like I said, common goals. And I'm going to push my preparedness classes, because I think, look, being self-reliant, teaching others to be self-reliant and rugged and an individual, when you teach somebody to be an individual, they're not going to go along with the crowd like all those people who are kneeling. They're going to do what they think is right. You know, teach them to think for themselves. You empower somebody when you teach somebody how to take care of themselves, how to think ahead and not be dependent on others and the government. There's nothing wrong with that. And you know what? It helps the law enforcement. It develops strong relationships with the law enforcement. And we know we need that, right? If that's an issue that's on the other side, well, then you know what? You need to build alliances with the law enforcement. That's just my little plug. I'll let you guys know about those classes that we're going to be coming up with a website, hopefully in the next couple weeks. So anyway, stay tuned, because I do believe that is a way to bring Americans together, real Americans that love our freedom. All right, let's move on. Let's move on quickly, because I wanted to touch on the thousands, you know, all those victims of the hurricane that are coming, and yet we are still bringing in refugees. And I believe President Trump, I don't know if he's decided yet on, listen, he can seriously stop the whole refugee program. He can pause it, take an operational pause. That is what needs to happen, because we need to be spending, if we're spending money at all on people that are hurting, it should be Americans first, right? Treat Americans first that are hurting. $290 billion or more is the cost of what Harvey and Irma to the U.S. economy can be, that's what they're expecting it to cost. For the cleanup and the damage that needs to be repaired. Anyway, keep an eye on that refugee number, because it should be zero, and there's no reason why. I mean, there's no reason why people wouldn't understand that. We've got to take care of our own. Want to point out one more thing, too, before the show ends, and I do want you all to go to that WND article. I don't know if I'm going to have time to get to it, but you've got to read about the man in Oklahoma. It was, you know, the Muslim that beheaded the woman in Oklahoma. I think it was like a chicken processing plant. But if you guys would please head over to WND, I believe it's WND.com, and I'm trying to get the name. I'll get the name of that article for you here. Let me find it. Hold on. But that needs to be, I mean, you know, people, that should be on the mainstream media. Mainstream media should be absolutely covering that story, because it's an incredible story. And also the other thing they're not covering is there was a Sudanese, I think it was a Sudanese immigrant, shoots up, you know, a white church, right? The media gave it, I think, a half a day of coverage. And Dylan Roof, he was the one that shot that, you know, mostly black, the black church in Charleston. And that was, you know, weeks, if not months of coverage. But, anyway, his is called, it's in the Quran. It says the Muslim who beheaded the Oklahoma co-worker. That's WND.com, Leo Homan. All right, so let's touch on this story about the fentanyl. I don't know if you all saw this huge story. This is in the New York, I think it's New York Times. Enough fentanyl to kill 32 million people was seized in a single New York City bust. The drugs are worth a street value of $30 million, according to narcotics prosecutors. Yeah, this is unbelievable. 195 pounds of fentanyl were seized. Listen, this is, and I said before, I mean, I think it's probably obvious, but this is like an asymmetric type warfare situation. Heroin and fentanyl, and they're mixing it, I guess. But the fentanyl, I think 2016 was the highest as far as lethal, you know, overdoses. In New York's five boroughs, all time high. But listen, that is, I mean, the drugs, people, it's very sad what's going on. And like I said, this is in rural areas too. It's not just big New York City. And I think those of you in listening, you know what I'm talking about. We have got to get a handle on the border. Because definitely with heroin, like you said, we don't produce one iota of heroin in this country. Something is allowing this stuff to come in, and it's ruining our young people. And our young people, look, are the future of this country. And these kids, and I've seen it, believe me, I've seen it. They get hooked on this stuff, and it is so hard to get off. And if they even live through it. I was reading some article too the other day about, you know, just about how prevalent it is everywhere. This article was saying that I guess there were just four people I think were involved in this huge bust. It's historic. But hats off to those law enforcement that, you know, undercover. That's got to be a scary job of what those guys do. And once again, want to give a shout out to those law enforcement, to our military, to those that do that, not in the military exactly, but they are protecting our country in many ways where they never get, you know, they never get the shout outs. They never get public displays, you know, of thanks. I just want to thank those out there listening who do so much for our country, and many of them can't say what they do. Very thankful for those people. And I want you all to have we're coming up on the end of the show, and I promise I will have somebody on next week. I can't say who it is right now, but we will have some interesting people to interview in these next coming weeks. Thank you so much for listening to my show, and you all have a wonderful week, and I will be back next week. Take care.